God spent a year humbling me. I was proud. I wasn't willing to admit that I had a God. I wasn't willing to admit that I had a higher power or a creator. It's a humbling truth. The devil wants to keep you in pride. Pride says you will not accept the truth that there is a loving God, a God of love. He who loves is of God, for God is love. The author of love, not just in word and tongue, but he showed us it on the cross. On a cross, when God incarnate, the very Son of God who made this planet, died the most painful, excruciating death for every single one of you within the sound of my voice. If you're looking for more meaning in this life, if you're tired of doing what the world says to do, if you're tired of Facebook, if you're tired of Twitter, if you're tired of getting drunk every weekend because you have no meaning in your life, I'm here to tell you today that there is meaning. Every single one of you, I don't care what colour you are, I don't care whereabouts on this planet you are from, you are made in the image of God. That means your life is precious. You are not just an animal. Every single one of you are made in the image of God, and I love you. I love you so much that I'm willing to stand here today and take your hostility, take your hatred, and take me look like a loony, because I love you, I care for you, and the truth that set me free can set you free. I was suicidal after 20 years on this planet, taking the devil's lies in the education system, thinking that I was just a monkey, thinking I was just an animal. And so one day I humbled myself. And that's what it takes, my friends. It takes a need to humble ourselves and say, wait a minute, maybe there is a God. And if there is a God, how do we find him? Well, God has already fulfilled this for us. God says, I live in heaven, and there is only one way to get to me. That is through my Son. And he who believes on the Son has eternal life. My friends, this is for eternity. You will remember these words one day, and I'm here to tell you that I love you. God loves you. He cares for you. Your life does have meaning. Every single one of you, you don't have to get drunk anymore. You don't have to get high. You don't have to have sex with every single person you see. I'm here to tell you today that you are made in the image of God, and you are responsible to a higher power. Our ancestors knew this. You go over all this part of the planet, they will tell you that there is a God. Our ancestors knew this, and they knew this because they handled a stable society in which Christ reigned. Oliver Cromwell prayed that the name of Jesus Christ would be glorious. The name of Jesus Christ would be glorious in the land of England. And it used to be. And the name of Jesus Christ is glorious. God bless you. I love you. Jesus loves you. He doesn't care about your past. He doesn't care about how many years of drug addiction, how many people you've slept around with. He cares about your soul. He cares about your eternal destiny. Don't believe the television. Don't believe the propagation, the propaganda of the lies instituted by the news networks, by the prince of the power of the air, who is the devil himself. He doesn't want you to come to Jesus, because as soon as you come to Jesus, he has no power over you. He is defeated. He is the devil of a defeated being. There is no need to fear him. But I will show you whom you should fear. Fear him. The last thing he has killed has the power to cast into hell. My friends, Jesus Christ warned us about such a place called hell. I know it's become so in the use of everyday language that it doesn't grab the soul and the spirit anymore. But something deep down within you knows there is a hell. I knew this. And I said, Lord Jesus, please enter my heart. I'm a moral sinner. Look at me, I'm as weak as a weak man could be on a weak day. But I have something, my friends, and it's called the Spirit of the Living God. The Spirit of the Lord Jesus Christ dwells in me, and he is talking to you now. And he is saying, I'm giving you a choice. I'm opening my hand in love to you. I'm saying, for 1 second, just humble yourself, just like I did. I wanted to kill myself, so it brought me to a place of humility, a place where I was willing to accept that there is such a thing as God. And if this God is real, this is a God who we hugged. This is a God who came and dwelt among us, and we fasted for 40 days. He's known hunger. He's known no pain that you could ever possibly imagine. And he suffered the wrath of his Father, the almighty wrath of God, which should have fallen on me. It should have fallen on me, and it should have fallen on you. But it fell on his Son at the cross of Calvary. The wrath of almighty God, the holy wrath of the eternal God, fell upon his Son. Why? Does God not love his Son? Did the Father not care about his Son? Of course the Father loves the Son more than anyone. The Father has given everything into the hands of the Son. Every single one of you are made in the image of God. You are made in the image of Jesus Christ. And in the womb, you are not just a fetus, but God breathes an eternal spirit into you. My friends, this is good news. You can be forgiven like I was, like that. And every time I do wrong, God said to me, I said, God, I think I'm going to hell. He said, no, you're not, George. You repent. That's all I ask. He then said, you believe in my son. What more can I ask of you? And the question is today, to you, my friend, does your conscience bear witness if the Holy Spirit is moving in your life and convicting you that the life of slavery to sin has run its course? It's not freedom, my friends. Watching that rap music where they glorify the things that God abominates. Listening to that heavy satanic rock music which tells you you can do whatever you want and there's no consequences. But my friends, I'm here to tell you that there are consequences to sin. For the wages of sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Eternal life, my friends. Where will you be 10,000 years from now? 10,000 years from now, where will you be? I know where I'll be. I'll be worshipping the Father in heaven. I'll be worshipping Jesus in heaven. And you may ask me, why do I believe in God? Because the Holy Spirit bears witness with my spirit that Jesus Christ loves me. And he loves you just as much as he loves me. He doesn't love me any more than he loves you. He cares about you. You've put down the lies of the devil. The devil will deceive you into thinking that you are just a monkey. Climb up on the animal chain. I mean, if you believe you're a monkey, then you can never contradict him when you act like an animal. I'm here to tell you today, you are not an animal. You are made in the image of God. And there is greatness inside of you. There is potential inside of you to become the very temple of God.
The everlasting Father.
The temple of the Holy Spirit who dwells in me. Who empowers the most weakest man on this planet to stand before you all.
So I love
you.
Revelation
I care about you. I care for your soul. And I fear God. And because I fear God, I don't fear man. Oliver Cromwell says, when I fear God, I do not fear man. I do not fear man. I love man. For the fear of man brings a snare. For he who trusts in the Lord will be kept safe. My friends, the Lord keeps me safe. He can keep you safe. He wants to wake you up. I saw a man once which had a billboard saying, wake up, Satan's brainwashed cattle. And I had respect for that man. Even though I didn't believe in Jesus, I had respect that a man was willing to stand there, not going with the flow. The world will tell you that just go with the flow. Just do what everyone else is doing.
It does, mate.
If that's
John,
the meaning of lies, if that's where your potential is,
says,
is your potential following the crowd?
Before Abraham was,
by the education system, being brainwashed by the television, which removes your independent thought.
Before
it
Abraham
stops your
was,
ability to think.
I am.
And my friends, I've been out behind the sky today.
The Old Testament,
then I saw
God
something like chemtrails. And then I saw the clouds.
God,
my friends, this is over every city.
My name
but the power of the Almighty God is stronger. He is stronger. There is no conspiracy
Jesus
against God.
Name for himself.
There is no Illuminati which can stand against God. God sees everything. He knows everything. There is nothing to fear from these conspiracy theories. There's nothing to fear from them. They just want to stop you from believing in Jesus.
I am God.
By filling your mind with filth.
I've just told you, use the name of God for
propaganda.
Himself.
But I'm here to tell you today that I love you. I care about every single one of you. Jesus Christ shed his blood for every single one of you.
If I didn't,
he died
if I was
a Muslim,
I was looking at religion.
My friend, this is common
and
knowledge.
I ask someone, does
you
Jesus say anyway he's God? Like, I am God.
And you mention the name of Jesus.
No, I am.
Immediately, when you hear his name,
a mistake,
when you hear the name of
when
Jesus,
you said if I wasn't a Muslim,
there is something within
you
which wants to revolt.
Not
which wants to
rebel.
I know,
my
but you're not near to
the truth.
But if I was,
come to a knowledge of the truth.
So I can't. So
that Jesus Christ is more stronger.
Yeah, but they're not neutral.
The spiritual entity,
they're not neutral. Nobody's neutral. Everybody is biased. The atheist looks at the world with the atheist glasses. Muslim looks at the world with the Muslim glasses. Christian looks at the world with the Christian glasses. Everybody is biased.
Look before you know.
So that neutral argument doesn't work because all the arguments that you're making are from an Islamic perspective. So what we have to do is go to the Quran and see if that is the authority to read the Bible.
This was common knowledge.
And I would say that it's not the authority to read the Bible. Because, number one, the Quran has changed. All right. Have you read Bukhari about Uthman?
Became common practice.
Have you read Bukhari about Uthman?
You need to wake up, just like I had to wake up.
What does Bukhari say about Uthman?
He says,
do not lie to yourselves, O people. No one is a god.
Yeah. And what happened then?
Until you die to discover the truth.
And what happened to
about
the other books?
It's too late. God is merciful. He is merciful beyond my words' comprehension. My friends, God is holy.
Guess what?
Christ holy. Holy,
if you say to me the Bible's changed, I can show you ancient Greek manuscripts, because we didn't burned the rock, okay? So we have the evidence.
But Christians are interested in the punishment of Jesus.
But if you burn
the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world,
it's just a vacuum.
He's taken away my sin.
Christian scholar says Jesus.
Okay, who?
Every time I've
there's a guy,
it's
a speaker's corner.
I went
and spoke to Jay Smith.
Not because I'm worthy.
He said
because he loves
you. Yeah, but Jay Smith. No, but Jay Smith. It's not a good textual critic.
I care about you.
He's an apologist. He's not a good textual critic.
Satan's brainless cattle. There is such a thing as heaven. There is such a thing as hell.
You can make your choice right now.
God has given you the free will. Do I love him or hate him?
But we're not robots, you see.
We are not robots. We have a free will.
But prophets.
And you can choose to exercise your free will.
So even in your own Quran, it says how to change.
To be enmity with him, or to choose to say no.
No,
I'm going to humble myself
here.
And I'm
going to
say, if there is a God, then he wants to be known. And if he wants to be known, how can he be known? And the answer is found in Jesus Christ.
Have you ever lied?
Jesus, the Christ.
When God meets a liar, what's he going to do with the liar?
He prophesied hundreds of years before he walked the face of his planet. Jesus, the Christ.
But instead of judging you, Jesus Christ is the Lamb of God that sacrificed himself. John the Baptist. When John the Baptist saw Jesus, he said, behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world.
Just accept. Just humble yourself. Humble yourself to the mother of the truth. Jesus loves
sacrifice
you.
Yourself.
I love you.
Without that sacrifice, there's no forgiveness of sin.
I care about every single one of you.
Why wouldn't there be a sacrifice?
In heaven.
Because in the Old Testament, we have the story of Abraham where God told him to sacrifice his son and then provided a ram. So God is already teaching about sacrifice.
The perfection,
you don't believe God provided a ram for Jesus.
The worship, the glorious priest that could be yours.
So there's a sacrifice in the Old Testament there. And then the high priest was told to sacrifice animals for Israel. Then we have Isaiah 53, a prophet says that Jesus was bruised and punished for our sin.
So in the Old Testament,
the Jewish teachers were all about sacrificing sin.
So
when John the Baptist prophet saw Jesus, he said, behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. And then in Mark chapter 10, Jesus says, I give my life for ransom for many.
You don't have to do these things.
So there's all sacrifice there.
God loves you. He loves you so much that he gives you life and breath to breathe. He sent his son to die the most painful, excruciating death anyone could ever imagine. Why? Why would God do that? Because he loves you. He cares every single one of you. I'm not here to attack you. I'm here to tell you that I love you. And I'm here to give you the truth. The truth that will set you free. Just like my suicidal thoughts were set free that night. When I said, Lord Jesus, please enter my heart.
So Jesus wants you to have a peace. And a joy and a knowledge of God in a way that you could never imagine.
A
peace and a love filling your heart by believing in
Jesus Christ.
Let me ask you a question from a Muslim point of view. Jesus said this in John 14. He said,
I am the way,
the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father but through me. What do you think about that? I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father but through me.
There is no lie in the Holy Bible. In fact, it is impossible for God to lie.
I'm the way.
You cannot lie.
Do you know that's the name of Allah? The 99 names of Allah. You look at the 99 names of Allah. He's the way.
God is a wrathful God.
99 names of Allah.
He's life. And he will execute judgment on evil.
And
he said this to me one day.
Those are three names of Allah. And yet Jesus uses it for himself. I'm the way, the truth, and the life.
I said, no, the devil. How about when you throw the devil into the lake of fire? Surely you'll rejoice. Father, he said, not even him, George.
My problem
God
is,
does not delight in the death of the wicked.
The
he does
basis.
Not delight in throwing anyone to hell. But because of his holiness, his justice, and his perfection,
not
he has to do it. Because if not, he wouldn't be a righteous God. He wouldn't be a holy God if he didn't punish sin. And this is where Jesus comes in.
To preach him,
and Jesus said,
surely
I say to you, who raised my voice and believes in him and sent me, has everlasting life, and shall not come into judgment
for his past. He went to the temple, he shaved his hair,
he made sacrifice. I know, because I did it for 20 years of my life. I lived
and then later,
the
biblical commentators
God, which I didn't
say that he had to
even.
Repent because
when one day I humbled myself because I was desperate.
Caved,
I was in pain.
The Lord
brought affliction upon me.
The Romans
and
said,
the Lord
we already eat pork.
I didn't have any friends
so we're
anymore.
Not that.
I began
if
popular.
You to us,
I ended up a drug abuse.
A
drug addict. An alcoholic.
What source are you reading from? What were you getting
I looked up to the sky and I said, said there is no meaning? Ask yourself this question. Does your life have true meaning?
Is it in the Bible or some outside source?
Before
you go to bed in the
But the earliest source that you need to read for the early church is the Book of Acts. In the Book of Acts, there's preaching. And the sermons there, the preaching, Christ died, Christ rose again. If you repent and believe in him, you can be saved. That's the message in the Book of Acts. And that's what the early church was preaching.
Yeah?
So whatever scholars are saying, there are many, many academics out there. We have freedom in the West to critique Christianity. So you've got many scholars that attack Christianity. You haven't got the same in Islam.
You have the freedom, dude.
Yeah, no, you haven't. You haven't. There are very few scholars that actually, in Islam, critique and attack Islam. Whereas in Christianity, we have thousands of scholars that do that because they have the freedom to do that. So you haven't got that freedom. So it's not good using our scholars. They're attacking us because they have the freedom to do that. You've got to get it from your scholars as well. Show me where. Show me. You know, we've got Bart Ehrman. I don't agree with him. But what's your equivalent of Bart Ehrman in Islam?
That's the only sin.
Personally, I believe
there isn't a Bart Ehrman in Islam.
People have criticized the religion from within.
Name
as not as a means.
Like a vicious criticism, as a means to show
that there's nothing wrong with the Quran. They criticize it to the point that they bring up all the evidences, scientific as well, and they critique it against the Quran, and they come to the conclusion that they go hand in hand.
You can
bring me an argument in the Quran which is false.
The main thing is Jesus says, I've come to give life, and life abundantly.
But the part is that Jesus is not like God. In the Book of Deuteronomy,
I'm not sure which chapter it is.
It's better if you just preach out without the mic now. It's just crackling, you know. You just turn it off and just at the bottom on the right side. At the bottom here, mate. Down there, yeah. There's no point in using it now, it's just... It's not sounding well, yeah?
Alright.
Alright, mate. So...
In the Book of Deuteronomy, the story of the fig tree, you've heard of it, yes?
Yeah, just so, preach without the mic, if you want.
Jesus is hungry and he sees a fig tree. He goes, I'm hungry. His disciples are with him. He goes to the fig tree. He sees it from far, so he assumes it's more fruit. He goes up to it and it's withered. There's no fruit on the tree. He goes, I curse this tree and let it bear no fruit for the rest of his life.
Yeah.
Why? And I've asked Christian people about this, scholars, and some preachers as well. And they've said the tree is representative of humanity who have rejected Jesus.
Well, if you read the gospel, if you read the Bible, the fig tree is actually, if you read the Bible, I can't think of the reference off the top of my mind, but if you read the references in the Bible, the fig tree is a reference to Israel. It's mentioned a lot. In the Old Testament, Israel is the fig tree.
So, I don't know where you're going from. The fig tree is innocent. He went up to the fig tree when it was off season. It was not the fig tree's fault that it didn't bear fruit. So Jesus is basically saying, you are innocent, but I still curse you.
No. Whenever the prophets, if you look at the history of prophets, when prophets are doing their work, they use signs and symbols to get their message across, right?
It doesn't make sense.
Wait. So for example, a Jew would know that a fig tree was a symbol of Israel. Jesus come first of all to the lost sheep of Israel, and he's preaching and they're rejecting him.
That's all he came to.
No, wait. He was preaching to the lost Israel, and so he's giving a picture and saying that I'm now going to the Gentile. It's now for the Gentile because you're rejecting the message. And the fig tree is a symbol of that.
The fig tree is innocent. Israel were innocent. So why do you use a victory.
Not the because he's a prophet. He can use Jesus is the Son of God. He can do whatever he wants.
He can do whatever. It doesn't make sense.
It does make sense.
I'd expect God to make sense.
Have you studied the prophets the way they use illustrations? You will find if you've studied the Israel prophets, the Jewish prophets.
Every single prophet they use connotations.
I'll give you an example. The prophet Jeremiah had to buy some land, and that was a symbol. Many prophets had to do things that were crazy. For example, God told Hosea to marry a prostitute to teach that Israel is not faithful. So God does these things, bro. He teaches us by these lessons. He's teaching by the victory.
That makes sense.
Yeah, but you can home in on the victory, but a Jewish mindset would know that a victory represented Israel. John, victories. Did the victory represent Israel? When Jesus cursed the fig tree, was that representing of Israel that they're rejecting the gospel?
The way I see it is this. The fig tree represented sin.
There you go, sin represents.